Well, good afternoon. I think we are in conditions to start the second plenary session. I hope you have enjoyed the lunch, but now it's time to restart working. And first, I would like to say that it's our pleasure to have with us Professor Viriat Surmany Marques. I really would like to thank you for your availability to share with us your knowledge and your reflections on a very interesting theme that starts with a provocative question. Who are we? The doctrine of Laudato Si on the nature and tasks of sustainability science and scientists. But before Professor Viriato says who we are, we will know something about who he is. And please show. Is it? If technology fails, I will ask Professor Viriato to.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me even in the opposite sides of the room? It's a great pleasure and honor to be here, and I wish to greet and to thank Tomás Ramos, Rui Santos, and Sandra Caeiro for this invitation and also for organizing this great event. I am sure that I am aware that the conference is attended by over 500 people coming from 48 countries, different countries. So this is indeed a cosmopolitan atmosphere. And we are all united by the topic of sustainability. And sustainability is precisely the opposite to the Babel Tower. So we are from different cultures, countries, but we are able to bind together, to talk together precisely upon the topics of sustainability. I was invited to talk to you about the Laudatio Si. As you know, the word of Pope Francis last year about the matters of environment, climate change, the great ontological crisis where humanity is embarked on. And I want to address the topic in four main moments. The first one will be basically a depiction or a commentary on the Laudato Si, establishing the links that Pope Francis chose in order to connect his message with the tradition of the Catholic Church, but also of other domains of Christian and non-Christian tradition. So that will be probably the part of my presentation in which I will address more directly the text of Pope Francis. In the following three parts, I will address, I will tackle the issues of the contents. I'm sure that I'm not going to quote directly, extensively. What I'm going to try to do is to present you, to share with you my reading of the letter and the thought of Pope Francis in these three main areas. I think that Pope Francis gives us a comprehensive and accurate view of the global environmental crisis. I think also that we may find here what I usually call the technological fallacy and the oblivion of the ethical reasoning. And finally, and this is basically the most important issue for us, I think that Pope Francis appealed to us as citizens and as scientists also to be active members in the next revolutionary back to science, back towards science. So we need to shift our scientific paradigm, and it will be in this back towards direction. Let's try to do it in order to preserve time for discussion. Well, starting from what I call a negative positive. So this is indeed a warm reception. You know, this is a quotation from an interview of Jeb Bush, the late candidate of the Republican Party in the United States. And I think that it's very positive for Pope Francis that he received a so-called reception. Jeb Bush said that he was very upset, as you may see in the slide, very upset with the message of Pope Francis, and said that I don't get economic policy from my bishops or my cardinal or my pope. Jeb Bush is a new Catholic, so this is very interesting to see how resilient are other interests besides the moral or religious interests. But this is just an incident. The essential issue is that Pope Francis connects his message with the larger tradition of Christian and spiritual thought. We may find in the first paragraphs of the encyclical of the Laudato Si, we may find there the presence of former popes, recent popes of the 20th century. We may find also the connection with traditions that come from other schools of thought in the Christian tradition, and also from other great religions in the world. So there is what is usually called the ecumenic spirit. We have here a huge and effective ecumenic spirit. Well, we have Pope John the 23rd, we have Pope Paul the 6th, and I put in bold the main messages that we may find. So Pope Paul wrote that due to an ill-considered exploitation of nature, humanity, and he wrote that in 71, humanity runs the risk of destroying it and becoming in turn a victim of this degradation. So Pope Francis tells us that I'm not the first one to write about this. John Paul II did also some work in this domain. He wrote that to see no other meaning in their natural environment than what serves for an immediate use and consumption. So he was critical to anthropocentrism, to the way in which humanity tends to use nature as a kind of just raw materials, like a number, an infinite number of resources, material resources, forgetting that they are organically tied and they depend upon each other, one upon each other. The same for Benedict XVI. He wrote, man is not only a freedom which he creates for himself, man does not create himself, his spirit and will, but also nature, and also where we ourselves have the final world, where everything is simply our property and we use it for ourselves alone, The misuse of creation begins when we no longer recognize any higher instance than ourselves, when we see nothing else but ourselves. You may tell me, and I will agree with you in that case, that, well, this is environmental ethics, at least in it could be, and it is environmental ethics, in a broader sense. This is basically also a consideration on ethics that takes into consideration the need to put humanity in a larger framework of entities. Even for someone who is not atheist, even for someone who doesn't believe in such creature as God, this makes sense. Why? Because we, humanity, live in a very complex system, a very complex ecosystem, material, flows of energy, intellectual ecosystem as well, and we are connected. So it has no sense to put as a goal of the system only the self-interest of one part of the system. So this is an old thought about the need to have a coherent connection between the parts and the whole. But this is the most important part of the theoretical reflection of Pope Francis is precisely, that's my thesis in this conference, that he connects directly with Saint Francis of Assisi. So he goes back in Laudato Si to a kind of lost treasure of the Christian tradition. And I'm going to quote a historical text that was written, I'm going to show very quickly before reading. It was written 1967 by Lynn White Jr., the historical roots of our ecological crisis. It's a milestone text in which Lynn White told us how deeply our ecological crisis is connected with our core values and with the tradition of Christianity. So he was able to tell us that the dominant tradition in European Christianity and Western Christianity is open to the possibility of using the earth as raw materials. So, in that sense, what Pope Francis is doing right now is coming back to another minor tradition, that of Francis of Assisi, that defended or vindicated a completely different perspective. So the perspective of fairness between humans and all the other entities that belong to the larger concept of nature. Fairness, equality, respect. That's what Lynn White wrote in a rather prophetic way, because he proposed in 67 that Saint Francis should be the saint patron of ecologists. And indeed, in 1978, he was promoted to that condition. So there was indeed the acceptation by the Holy Priest, by the Pope, in 78, that Saint Francis would be, he is our protector, so to say. But let's read the text of Lynn White Jr. The key to an understanding of Francis is his belief in the virtue of humility, not merely for the individual, but for man as a species. Francis tried to depose man from his monarchy over creation, I would say absolute monarchy, it was not a constitutional monarchy, and set up a democracy of all God's creatures. With him, the hand is no longer simply an homily for the lazy, flames a sign of the trust of the soul toward union with God. Now, with Francis, they are brother ant and sister fire, praising the creator in their own ways as brother man does in his. the greatest spiritual revolution in Western history, Saint Francis, so this is a main proposition of Ellen White, proposed what he thought was an alternative Christian view of nature and man's relations to it. He tried to substitute the idea of equality of all creatures, including man, for the idea of man's limitless rule over creation. He failed, at that time at least. Both our present science and our present technology are so tinctured with orthodox Christian arrogance toward nature that no solution for our ecological crisis can be expected from them alone. And finally, since the roots of our trouble are so largely religious, the remedy must also be essentially religious, whether we call it that or not. We must rethink and refill our nature and destiny. The profound religious but heretical sense of the primitive Franciscans for the spiritual autonomy of all parts of nature may point a direction. I propose Francis as a patron saint for ecologists. So this is, in my opinion, one of the core values that we may find in the word of Pope Francis. And he addresses two main ideas that are in the title of this conference. On one hand, we are, of course, putting in question the type of modern relationship of civilization with nature, but on the other side, and deeply, even deeply than that, we are putting again the question, who are we? So the way in which we deal with nature is essential to answer the question about our identity as individuals and as a species. Going to the second part, now I will try to show my reading of the main critical thesis contained in the Laudato Si. And I think indeed that it presents a comprehensive and accurate view of global environmental crisis. That's why I find a lot of common understanding between Pope Francis and also the debate that we have now starting into the year 2000 with the proposal of Paul Crutzen about the new era, the Anthropocene. I think that we have indeed here the echoes of that debate. Pope Francis tells us in different words the main message that is already in the debate about if we should or not substitute Holocene by Anthropocene. And basically, the question is human responsibility. We are shaping the face of the Earth. We are indeed the most active plastic actor in the world. In all the systems, we are changing the biosphere, but also the geology of the planet, the atmosphere, the water, the cryosphere. So we are acting so actively in reshaping what we call the planet, the world, that we are responsible for long-run shifts. We introduced changes that will last for millennia and for millions of years. So this is a huge challenge. And until now, and Pope Francis write about this as well in the encyclical, in the Laudato Si, we live in a process that is very risky, very dangerous. This is a slide from Will Steffen and colleagues, the project they developed on planetary boundaries. And in many of the great macro indicators, we just picked those six, but there are many of others in the macro indicators, we have exponential curves of growth regarding the impact and basically the negative impact upon the carrying capacity of our Earth system. So this is precisely the picture regarding the 9 planetary boundaries identified by Will Stephan and colleagues. And as you may see, we have 3 of them in which we are beyond the red line. We are in deep trouble. The biodiversity depletion loss and also climate change, for instance, are some of the most intensively endangered frontiers or boundaries of our global ecosystem. And we need, indeed, to reinvent the way we dwell on Earth, that's for sure. As you know, at least for 30 years, we discuss the nature, the risky nature of our society. It was 30 years ago that Ulrich Beck wrote the famous book, Risiko Gesellschaft, Risk Society. And indeed, we have plenty of evidences that we are in a risk society. And Pope Francis addresses the fact that we are not jeopardizing. When we jeopardize the environment, we are also putting lives in danger, actual lives and the lives of the future, in the life of the future generations. We have many examples of, just picked some of them just to recall your memory about this, the adventure of the RLC as ecopolitical tragedy. The 3 George Dam, the uncertain price of hubris. The dolphin that you see over there disappeared. We have a similar species in the Amazon River, but it was there for millennia and millennia, and it disappeared. Even in a high-organized society like Japan, high-civilized, organized with a great sense of order, it was possible Fukushima. And it was indeed the perfect storm, the combination of an earthquake with a tsunami and political and technological arrogance. The area where the plant was located is a very known tsunami area. We have records there of very high waves, tsunami waves. And do you know what was the height of the wall that protected the center of the power station? 6 meters. So the wave of 14 meters overcame the wall and caused a huge destruction. And probably the most threatening problem in our anthropocentric and anthropic shifting of our planet, of our own planet, is indeed climate change. James Anson wrote some years ago, Storms of My Grandchildren, a book in which I think he found the right metaphor, Venus Syndrome. Contrary to what we read in our fiction books or in fiction movies, we are not sending spacemen and spacewomen to outer planets in order to create a similar Earth atmosphere in those planets. On the contrary, we are embarked in an adventure that is Venus transforming our planet. We are, as he said, I have come to conclude that if we burn all reserves of oil, gas and coal, there is a substantial chance we will initiate the runaway greenhouse. I believe in the Venus syndrome. And we are indeed in a great crisis. I propose to you, this is not from the words of the Pope, but anyway, I think there is no contradiction between this slide and what is written by Pope Francis. We are indeed in a new, completely different crisis. Environmental crisis is really the only global crisis we have in the world. First, it has a planetary dimension, like climate change, for instance. There is no other crisis that is so planetary. Finance crisis is not planetary. I think there is no crisis in Antarctica, no finance crisis in Antarctica. But there is climate change crisis in Antarctica. Irreversibility and entropy, the case of biodiversity extinction. Cumulative acceleration, the problem that we have of justice between generations. We are failing our duty to offer the coming generations a safe planet. We are living upon the wealth and the good conditions of our planet, so we are lending to the future, lending from the future. And also, it's a crisis that will, more and more, will grow in the political arena. Will be very quickly also a political and social unrest crisis. We have that already in some parts of the world, in which some of the conflicts are, I would say, not caused, but are activated, are enhanced by environmental causes. Another main topic of the that I can identify in the words of Pope Francis is the technological fallacy and the oblivion of ethical reason. This is also for us that work in sustainable development issues, something that we know for many years. But it's very important to see how other traditions of thinking are able to interact with us in that domain. Indeed, we have a pattern of technological disaster. In all those events that I mentioned, in the pictures of Fukushima, RLC, and so on, we may identify those four elements. So, we are speaking of a more technological power than political wisdom. Vested interests are stronger than public interests. I am sure that in the case of Fukushima, for instance, the presence of vested interests connected with the energy lobby were more important in the easy attitude of the political power than the public interest. For instance, we know that in the case of Japan is the country of the world probably where the citizens are more protected against earthquakes. So in that sense, we have severe rules that avoid the loss of lives when, and it happens, it occurs many times in Japan, earthquakes. But in that specific case, like in many other cases, in many other countries of the world, the political power is very feeble regarding the pressure of the industry, of vested economic interests. There is also the linear causal planning instead of a holistic approach. That has to do with us, with our universities, with our technical departments. We need to refine the way we address planning. With linear causal planning, we are asking for tragedies like those I mentioned. There is also the arrogance of the will and poor scientific understanding of complexity. That's also an issue that does not compromise political decision makers, but also the scientific branch of the decision, the technical people involved in decisions. Sometimes we tend to not to give time enough for reflection and study and to go very swift in the wrong direction. And of course, priority to short term instead of long term strategic vision. That's probably the main cause, the aggregate concept of this slide is the first one. So the lack of long-term strategic vision and strategic action and planning. And why? What is the source of this? What is the root of this? I think we need to overcome a certain degree of naivety. This is something that has to do with our identity as Western culture, and now Western culture became global. The Western European tradition is now a universal tradition regarding science, technology. So we are speaking about humanity as a whole. But our tradition, indeed, starting in the modernity, starting in the 16th, 17th century, is indeed a culture in which episteme, so science, knowledge, is oriented to power, basically to technological power. We may see that in great utopias, Tommaso Campanella, Città del Sole, the Francis Bacon New Atlantis. We identify there not the classical ancient Greek conception of science, of episteme. Episteme, Aristoteles, Plato, they considered science as the contemplation of truth. So the idea, the pleasure of seeing how the world works, how nature works, we want more. Indeed, quoting Francis Bacon, the end of our foundations is the knowledge of causes, that's science, of course, and the enlarging of the bounds of human empire to the effecting of all things possible. That's what is typically Western and modern. So the idea of an effective science. Science is a recreation of the world, not a way just to contemplate and know how the world works. And we see that in every corner of our Western tradition, in every language. At the same time, a contemporary of Francis Bacon, Descartes, he wrote in the famous Discours de la Méthode, il est possible de parvenir à des connaissances qui soient fort utiles à la vie et ainsi nous rendre comme maître et possesseur de la nature. This is very strong, the idea that science will change us, will be like masters and owners of nature. This is very strong. This is not lost in translation. This is strong in French. This is strong also in Portuguese. The age, and much near from us, the age of production. The young Auguste Comte, he divided human history in two ages. The first age until the 19th century and the future after that. And he called, well, until now, we lived in the world of conquest. So people, countries, people stole with violent means resources from one another. Now we are embarking in another age, the age of production, l'âge de la production. The idea was that humanity will unite in a kind of final attack against the natural resources, so we'll become the kings of nature. Pour notre avantage, for our own benefit. And, well, this is, I think, a very interesting cartoon. Technology became the most secular popular religion. Indeed, we all have in our brain the idea that there is a silver bullet. So one of these days we'll see in the newspapers or in the internet that there was a solution, a technological solution for every problem. So that's why the guy over there, instead of helping the poor guy that is going to fall in the habits, just with the hands in the pockets, tell, oh, don't worry, technology will save you. So, and we are overcoming or crossing all the borders. I put you here a text, an old text from Bernal, a British scientist. It's a text from 1929. It was a very important text, both for science, but also for fiction, for philosophical reflection. And you may see that this is a kind of transhumanist prophecy. So he wrote, psychological and physiological discoveries will give the ruling powers the means of directing the masses in harmless occupations and of maintain a perfect docility under the appearance of perfect freedom. But this cannot happen unless the ruling powers are scientists themselves. This gave also origin to certain dystopias, like the admirable New World, that was a kind of fulfillment of the perspective that was entailed in this text from Bernal. But this is not over, this is not fiction, this is reality today. So we are now in the last frontier, and today the idea to have a transhuman species, a new species, to have a kind of conflict between old humans and new humans, is something that is not in the field of fiction. It's in the field of technological possibility. And I doubt that we have right now the ethical instruments and the political tools to launch the essential debate about this. This is an old text. This is not a new text. This is an old text, 2002. Gregor Stoke, he wrote, "Future generations will not want to remain natural if that means living at the whim of advanced creatures to whom they would be little more than intriguing relics from an abandoned human past." And I think that here we have the evidence that we are discussing also our identity. Who are we? What do we want to do with our human condition? Because there is no human nature. The human nature is the human condition. It's open to further progress, as we know. So this is also a very critical ethical, scientific, and political question. So to close my presentation, I think that also a very important content of the message from Pope Francis is indeed the challenge he launches to the scientific community. The new trends in technology, before Paul Crutzen, before the Anthropocene, before climate change as a main problem or environmental crisis, Hannah Arendt, a great thinker of German Jewish origin, who died as an American citizen, she wrote about something new that was happening. She wrote this in 61, and she was speaking about nuclear energy, nuclear science, nuclear technology, and she says that, okay, now science is doing something that is more like politics than it was before. So instead of like old technology using nature as raw material, with the nuclear science and technology, we were creating new entities in the world. So we are creating a kind of second nature. And that's politics. So we are doing politics in the connection with nature. And she died in 75. She didn't know nothing about nanotechnology, bioengineering, all those issues. And I think that we need to discuss the limits of technology. We need to be humble enough to understand that there are huge differences between in the complexity ceiling. It's completely different what is happening in the technology of information or in the technology of human transport. So we need to understand that there are no common speed for innovation. Sometimes innovation is indeed an ideological concept that instead of opening the avenues for reality, blinds us to the complexity of innovation and technological breakthrough. And we should not also forget that there are very important non-drivers of non-scientific drivers of science. We need to be humble enough to understand that scientific research as a societal process is driven also by many strong non-cognitive forces, finance constraints, personal narratives and expectations, vested interests, political agendas. And science is asked to produce technical operational solutions to market-oriented demands. That's why it's so easy to neglect complexity and small details. I recommend you the reading of a very important report from the European Environmental Agency, Late Lessons from Early Warnings, the second volume. The edition was published in 2013. It's full of examples in which the rules of science research was not respected on account of all the non-scientific drivers of research. And we need also to understand what is prudential approach. I think that Pope Francis invites us to be very prudent. And Thomas Omer Dixon, a Canadian scientist, wrote many years ago, 2003, what he called the ingenuity gap. And I think it's very, very intelligent what he advises us. I'm quoting, "We are indeed in the race between hard imaginative thinking, or what I call ingenuity, and the ever-expanding complications of our world. and in too many critical places and on too many critical issues we are losing the race. I think we should not read this message in a pessimistic way. This is just a depiction of what is happening. We have a time scarcity problem. We have two runners, the runner called problems, the other runner called solutions, and we need, if we want that solutions prevail over problems, we need to understand that we are behind. The problems are ahead of us. That's not pessimism. This is a realistic approach that we need to assume in our daily lives. And this is an academic forum, people not just from different cultures and countries, but also from different epistemic areas. And this is precisely a very great challenge. We speak many times about transdisciplinarity, interdisciplinarity, but it's so hard to overcome the barriers, the frontiers, the borders between sciences. And as someone coming from human sciences, from philosophy, from social sciences, I am the first one to agree with Bob Doggett in the sense that today, regarding the main issue of climate crisis and the environmental crisis, it's up to human sciences, social science, to go forward. So we should not ask anymore, because the decisive, the key words were already pronounced by chemistry, by climatologists, by earth scientists. We need to have key words from those who study economy, law, psychology, philosophy, sociology. Those are the members of our academic realm that are late to the crisis. Even the economists, even the ecological economists. That's why I'm proposing you that this is, I wrote a couple of texts about this some years ago, that we should find the right flag for our fight. And Professor Hans-Joachim Schellnhuber, one of the greatest European scientists and a good friend of mine, he wrote many years ago a text about what he called the second Copernican revolution. He wrote in Nature about the Earth system analysis as the second Copernican revolution. Well, I talked to him later and I proposed him another title. Of course, the text is published, so there is no opportunity to go back. There is no possibility to travel in time, at least now. So, for the future, I think that we should consider what is happening now with all the sustainability sciences, earth studies, earth sciences, and so on. Probably not the Copernican revolution, but the Ptolemaic revolution, because we are indeed coming back to Earth. As you know, in the Ptolemaic system, the Earth was the center of the universe. Of course, that when I'm calling to a Ptolemaic revolution, I'm using it as a metaphor. But a very important metaphor in the sense that we should pick, in terms of options, in terms of resource application, investment in science, we should precisely consider as a great priority to invest in every scientific research that vindicates our Earth, our ecosystem, that gives more time to tackle the great challenges of environmental crisis and climate change. And to close, now coming back to the text of Pope Francis, he wrote, paragraph 224, "Once you lose our humility and become entrailed, enchanted, with the possibility of limitless mastery over everything, we inevitably end up harming society and the environment. It is not easy to promote this kind of healthy humility or happy sobriety when we consider ourselves autonomous, when we exclude God from our lives or replace him with our own ego, and think that our subjective feelings can define what is right and what is wrong." As I told you previously, I think that the concept God here can be read in plenty ways. We don't need to be a Christian or to be atheist to consider this advice from Pope Francis, this appeal to humility, this appeal to the need to integrate in our identity the respect for the rest of the world, the idea that we have boundaries, that we have limits, as something that is basically a vital advice for our common survival and for a new dwelling of humanity in the earth. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Viriat, for this very interesting and provocative presentation. We start this session 12 minutes late, and we cannot increase this delay, so my proposal is that we take these few minutes available to make, to provoke some discussion and to raise some questions. So, people interested in... Joanar, here, please, in the first row.
My name is Jonas de Mel from New University of Lisbon in Portugal. I would like to thank Viriato. I as usually, I like very much what he said, both for sharing my principles and for thinking in a very different way from myself, which is why we are here after all, to discuss different thinking. I would like to provoke you with Pope Francis' encyclica that you did not explicitly mention, although part of them were implicit in what you said. One is that the very harsh criticism that Pope Francis makes against greed. A lot of what we are doing is about greed, wanting to have more than our neighbor, being better than our neighbor. A second is the last I would say call to action from Pope Francis in the final part of the encyclical. And my provocation is that I feel that we as scientists, we know a lot. We have given a lot, I think, to our world, but we are still missing a large part of the target. We are not working hard enough, or we are not on target on actually solving the problems that need to be solved. There is a clear lack of link of our scientific community to actually doing things on the ground to improve both the environment and the lives of our fellow citizens. Thank you.
Thank you, Jonas. Any other questions, comments from the audience? Please, third row in the left.
Robert Engelman with the World Watch Institute in Washington, D.C. I found it interesting that you quoted Pope Paul VI's concern about unchecked human activity in 1971. 3 years earlier, of course, Pope Paul VI was the author of Humana Vitae, which denied to women the right to plan their families. And in Laudato Si, Pope Francis rejected categorically any influence of human population size or growth as part of the environmental crisis, and continued to reject the idea that planning one's family might be a way appropriately to honor the human right to manage the timing and frequency of pregnancy and childbirth as individuals choose, as well as perhaps having beneficial impacts on the growth of population. I'm just wondering if seems he's relaxed that a little bit as a response to Zika, but there hasn't been any formal change in the Catholic Church's policy on this. I'm wondering if you see any connection between these issues and the crisis, or would you agree with his rejection of population and reproductive health as having any role whatsoever, positively or negatively, in the crisis? Thank you.
Thank you for our comment. Any other question, comment? No? So, Viriat, please. Yeah, the floor.
Thank you very much for both questions. And regarding the first one, the two points. The first one, even before the Laudato Si, as probably all of us remember well, Pope Francis wrote about an economic system that kills. So it was an open criticism regarding the prevalent market system that today is global. So it was a very strong criticism to at least the brand and the type of capitalist economy that we have right now. I'm sure that we can go farther than that, but anyway, it's very important to resume the debate about the economic system. As you remember, we had for many decades after the Second World War a two systems world, planned called socialist economy and the market-oriented economy, and now we have the illusion that there is only one type of market-oriented economy. I think there is the debate about the possibility of combining environmental protection, social rights, with a tamed market-oriented economy, tamed, so regulated, it's very important. So it's a task for us to do as citizens. The second issue, well, we all know that there is a great difference between knowing something about what is going to happen and being able to shift the causal events that will drive the things to really happen like we are foreseeing. And that's the task precisely of human sciences, like political science. So I think that what is lacking today is a more strong, effective understanding in the areas of social political sciences about the need to establish the transition path between knowledge and transformation of reality. So knowledge means that we are able to anticipate into the future, the long future, what is going to happen. Knowledge means that we know that there is a chain of causal connections that we need to break if we want to obtain a different outcome. But it's not up to scientists of natural sciences. Of course, as citizens they can and they should. James Hansen is always picking fights in the United States on coal mines and so on. But that's not the task of the IPCC, for instance. The task of many other scientific areas, academic areas, is precisely to help to perform the transition, the transmission process of anticipation, scientific anticipation, in order to affect reality and the way the political process is made. Well, Pope Francis. Pope Francis is fighting, in my view. That's my view as a citizen. So I'm not. I was raised here in Portugal in a Catholic family, but I must confess that for many years I have a problem with God and with the Catholic Church. I don't deny the influence of Catholic values in my vision of the world. I am sure, I usually tend to say that regarding to religion, we also have our copyright mark. So it's like it's better told in French, as you know, les célibataires, so the guys that live alone. The funny question is always, you are celibataire, avec who? Avec qui? With whom? So even the atheists or the agnostics are always connected with religious tradition. So I don't deny the impact of Catholic values and Catholic raising and tradition in my view of the world. However, I must say that what strikes me more in Pope Francis is the way she's moving very boldly against the dominant apparatus, the dominant hardware of the old Catholic Church. And I must say to you that he's not very popular in the place where he is the king, so to say. So, of course, I don't subscribe to the natality theories or the demographic theories of the Catholic Church. But anyway, we need also to be very self-critical, because we also should acknowledge that in the 60s and the 70s, we had a very inhumane approach regarding demographic planning. What was done in many third world countries on behalf of environmental sustainability was very ugly, very ugly. And at least in the last 30 years, I think that all the rational perspectives regarding how can we sustain the population growth are much more rational, and they are connected basically with human rights, with women rights. We know for sure now that the basic issue for demographic control is the empowerment of women. That's basic, the education of women, the empowerment of women. That's the basic issue. It's not vaccinate women, telling them that they are going to be vaccinated and they are being sterilized. That's awful. And we should be brave enough to understand that there are limits to what we can do.
Yes, unfortunately, we have to finish the session, so I just want to thank you once again for sharing with us your knowledge or your thoughts. And we have a small offer to you. It's a Portuguese thing, maybe you know, but it's just in Sina.
Thank you very much, Professor, for your presentation, and especially for this last message. Okay. And, there are projects from Portugal that you, I'm sure that you know already, but it's never too much. Thank you for
Okay, parallel sessions will start in 10 minutes, so at 2:50.